Hallelujah. So I don't know about you, but I kind of like to know how things work. Y'all out there? And one of the things I find about this whole God system is a lot of people just don't understand how it works. They have this funny idea that Jesus was born so we could have shopping malls and Christmas trees. And that's not why Jesus was born. Jesus was born to get us back to our Father, and to so that we could regain that place that Adam and Eve had on the planet before they sinned, that place of authority. And one of the things that you and I are supposed to walk in as Christians is authority. Amen. We're supposed to have authority over the devil, over the demons, over sickness, disease, poverty, depression, fear, anger. Y'all out there? And all that junk that you and I grew up with that we thought was, well, that's just what happens to people. Well, it is. That's what happens to people who don't know who they are in Christ. That's what happens to people who don't know their place and their authority from the Word of God. And we're talking about the authority because I believe that you can't be a good disciple and know what you're supposed to do without finding out in the Word who you are as a Christian and what's available to you. Amen? And so, just as you're going through your daily Bible reading, it's a good thing to meditate in it and to stick in it and read stuff over and over until it just becomes alive to you. Amen. So that God can speak to your heart and give you stuff to overcome life with. Y'all out there? Amen. And so I want you to turn with me this morning to a lot of chapters, as a matter of fact, because we should meditate on the Word, we should read the Word, and we should do the Word. Amen. In Ephesians chapter 1, what I want you to understand today, one of the things I want you to get today, is that when Jesus died on the cross and he rose again, he defeated the devil. The Bible tells us that the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So if there's stealing, killing, and destroying going on in your life, if he's stealing your finances, your health, your joy, your peace, it's the devil, it's not God. And what I want you to understand is you have complete and total authority over that. You don't have to be depressed, you don't have to be in fear, you don't have to be insecure, you don't have to be all that junk that the devil puts on folks. Are you out there? But you have to know your place. And the one thing I want you to get today is that when Jesus rose again, he is seated at the right hand of the Father in heaven, and so are you. And the one thing you want to get is that his authority is your authority. Are you out there? I watch a lot of Christians over the years, and a lot of them got saved, but that's as far as they got. And they never grew spiritually, grew in the Word of God to find out who they are in Christ, to find out what their responsibilities or their blessings were that they're supposed to have in their life. And I watch a lot of Christians who've been a Christian for a long time, but they're just as defeated as anybody who doesn't know Jesus. And if you know Jesus, you're supposed to grow spiritually, mature spiritually, and get over all of that carnal junk. Get delivered from all the garbage in your life and be a witness. Amen. Hallelujah. So Ephesians chapter 1 verse 20 says, talking about God, he says, he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him, that is Christ, at his right hand in the heavenly places. So where's Jesus? Jesus is seated in heaven at the right hand of God right now. Amen. He's not down here anymore. Remember, he was here. You probably don't remember that, but he was. It was a little before your time. But he was down here, but he's not now. Amen. Ephesians 2 verse 6 says this, that he raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So what I want you to understand is, as far as God's concerned, we know Jesus is in heaven. As far as God's concerned, so are you. You are seated in heaven spiritually with the same authority that Christ has. I know that's hard for us to grasp, but that's the way God sees us. He sees us seated with Christ with the same authority that Jesus has. And We need to understand now that spiritually we're not just down here fumbling around. We have a spiritual place with Christ where we have authority, and we don't have to take everything that the devil just pawns out to us. Amen. When he tries to tell you you're no good, you just look at him and say, "I read the back of the book. You know where you're going." Amen. You know, God's word and authority and confidence have to come out of our mouths. Amen. If it doesn't, it's either because we don't know it or we just don't do it. And a lot of us, we know stuff we don't do. Amen. But God has given us authority. And one of the things about a lot of Christians is they don't know they've been given authority. The devil has kept them in places where, you know, I know there's lots of churches. They don't believe in the church having any authority. You just go, when we all get to heaven, hallelujah. No, we have life here now. Are you all out there? We have life here now. We have authority here now. We're not waiting to get to heaven. Amen? And then Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 says this. Well, first of all, Ephesians 1:21 says that we are seated far above all principalities and power and might and dominion. Amen? Where are you? You're above all the trash. Y'all out there? Amen. You're above the trash. And then Ephesians 6:12 says, watch this. It says, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the principalities, against the powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. And when we read that, I don't want you to get the idea, we're in a fight against these demons. We're in a fight. No, they already defeated. You're not in a fight with those demons. You have authority over them. You have authority over the devil. You got authority over all his demons. Are you out there? And what do the demons do? They come to bring fear. Sickness, disease, y'all out there? Insecurity, they like to keep you hung up on whatever you've been hung up on your whole life, and so they can keep you defeated. God wants you walking in victory free of all the junk that you and I grew up with. When I grew up, my parents, my dad was he worked late. I think he worked late. He always came home late, drunk. And he would come home and him and my mom would just yell all night, and one morning we woke up and the TV was in the front yard, and it got there through the front window. And then one morning they got the thing fixed, and one morning we woke up and the TV was all shattered. And they used to fight all night. We'd wake up, us kids, me and my brother and sister, and we'd wake up and there'd just be screaming and cussing going on the whole night. Well, when we got married, my wife and I, my model for marriage was I go out and get drunk, come home and fight. That's what I was taught. Your kids don't pay any attention to what you tell them. They pay a great deal of attention to watching you. And then they just do what you do. And you don't have to tell them to act stupid. They just watch you. And then they act stupid. And they do exactly what you do. But for the first 5 of our years, marriage, we had hell on earth. And I can't believe this, but after 5 years, she said she was going to leave me. Like, are you kidding? Do you know who you've got here? She didn't care. She'd had enough. Are y'all out there? I said, well, if you leave, I'm coming with you. Amen. But God got into our life somehow. And in the 5th and a half year of our marriage, I got born again. She got filled with the Holy Spirit. I got filled with the Holy Spirit. And we got a hold of this. And I found out how marriages were supposed to be. I found out how husbands were supposed to be. I found out how dads were supposed to be. And I changed the way I thought from reading this, changed what I said about her, y'all out there, changed what I said about me, and got delivered from smoking, drinking, cussing, and raising hell through the knowledge of this. And with God's help, when I believed what it said, he made it real in my heart. Y'all out there? When I didn't know about this, I just thought, well, that's life. I drink, smoke, cuss, run around on my wife, and that's just life. It sucks, but sometimes it's fun. But it wasn't fun when I came home. But thank God, the last 37 years have been wonderful. Amen. Not because she got any more wonderful, but because God changed us through His Word. We found out what could be done in our situation, and we began to do it. Found out I had authority over drinking, smoking, cussing, and acting stupid. Y'all out there? When you don't know, you just think, well, that's just, everybody does, that's the way we are. No, you have authority over that. You don't have to be stupid. You can elect to be stupid and stay stupid, but you don't have to. Y'all out there? Why? I'm not just down here in the trash. I'm seated in heavenly places with Christ. And He has given me His authority on the earth to do what He would do if He was here. Y'all out there? Amen. But one thing, one of the big flaws I see with Christians that, I don't know, you end up in churches where people say, well, God put sickness on you. Well, show me that in the Bible. They can't show you that in the Bible because it ain't in there. But a lot of people say that because they don't know what the real answer is. Amen. But a lot of people have this funny idea that if God wants it, it'll just fall on us automatically. If He says we're blessed, we'll just be blessed automatically. Well, can I just tell you from watching a bunch of, not you, but the other people, those blessings don't just fall on you and start working. They start working when you find out what they are and you do something about it. Amen? Because you can know about them and not do anything with them and they still won't work. How many of you in here are born again? You actually know you're born again, you're saved, you're going to heaven. Let me see. Praise God. That's most of you. Some of you don't know. That's good. But how many know that Jesus died for you? Hallelujah. How many of you know that Jesus died for every sinner you don't like? He died for the creepiest, crummiest people in Portland. He died for them. He died for everybody who's still going to hell. So if He died for them, how come they're not saved? Because you have to do something with what you know. And if you don't know it, you can't do anything with it. You out there? You follow me? But once you find out what it is, then you have to do something. When I found out about Jesus dying for me, I had to do something about it. I didn't just go, oh, hallelujah, okay, and keep on living that way. I had to recognize that's for me, and I have to believe Him, be baptized, serve Him. Y'all out there? I had to do something. Well, for the promises that God has, they don't just fall on you either. He says that you're blessed in your finances. So that don't just fall on you. It's like Megan was saying, you have to be a sower. You have a part to play in order for that blessing to become real in your life. I mean, you can be blessed and still talk bad about other people. You know, you've probably never done this, but long time ago, I used to talk about people because that's what my family was good at. My mom, my aunt, my two aunts and my grandma, they'd sit around the table and kill everybody they'd come in contact with. They'd just talk them down about how stupid and ugly and everything they were. And us kids, we're just sitting there listening, taking it all in. And so we learned to do that. And one thing I learned is you can talk about somebody. You ever done this? You talk bad about somebody and they're not there. But then the next time you see them, they have a bad attitude towards you. It's like, did you hear what I said about you? But how many know there are demons? And they listen to what you say. And then they go to that person, and that person may not know what you said, but somehow they get a bad attitude about you. You ever experienced that? Yeah. I've done that in my whole life. It's like, who told them I said something to them? They're not supposed to. But the devil's alive, and the demons are working. Amen? But you and I, we need to find out what the Bible says is ours, what our authority is, and then do something with it. Because if we don't know what the Bible says, you can't do anything with it. Amen. Now, I like to shave in the shower, and I have a little mirror, you just little suction things you stick on the wall and shave, and it got old and funky, so I went to Fred Meyer's and I bought me a $12 mirror. And I put that on the thing, and I'm like, and it just fall off and wouldn't stick. And I'm like, $12. I'm taking this stupid thing back. $12. Stupid mirror. So I went and bought another cheapy one. It's a little tiny thing. It's stuck right there. And so I told, for Christmas last year, I told Megan, I told the kids, I want a mirror for my shower that sticks on the wall. And so Megan bought me that exact same mirror. But it had instructions. Because the first one I bought, I thought, any fool can work this mirror. I just threw the paperwork away. But I looked at the instructions. And you have to put it towards the wall and then tilt the mirror up straight out. Put it on the wall and then you bend it down and it suctions onto the wall. And I did that and I thought, that is so awesome. It sticks on, and it's a big mirror, and it's like, that is so, and I had one for a year that I couldn't use because I didn't know how to use it. You need to read the instruction manual so you know how things work. Amen? Because a lot of us, yeah, I've seen a mirror before. Yeah, any fool can work that mirror, you know. And we do that with things in life, and it doesn't work. But we're so prideful, we won't admit it didn't work for us. And I'm telling you, God wants you to walk in victory. God wants you to be blessed. He wants you to be healed, healthy, and whole. He wants your mind to be whole. Y'all out there? He wants you to physically be in great shape. Amen. But you have an enemy. The devil. And he comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. And if you don't know who it is that's trying to bring this against you, if you don't know what to do about it when he shows up, you're just going to suffer the same garbage you've suffered your whole life. Amen? Because it doesn't work automatically. I want to share with you, most of you probably don't know Brother Kenneth E. Hagin. He's been dead for a few years. But he's my spiritual dad, and he was a leader of the Bible school I went to back in 83, and he was a great man of faith, and he was constantly in the Word of God. What do you think about that? Think he was in the Word of God? He was in the Word of God, and he had a vision, a couple of visions from Jesus, with Jesus. And he wasn't seeking them, so don't go crazy. Oh, I got to have a vision. No, you don't need a vision. You just need the Word. If God wants to talk to you through a vision, he will, but you don't seek it. But he had a vision one time that I love, and he says Jesus appeared to him in his room, and Jesus and him were talking. And he said while he was talking, this little demon came up between them and just started going, yuckity, yuckity, yuck, yuck, and making so much noise that Brother Hagin couldn't hear what Jesus was saying. I want you to get this. And Brother Hagin was like, Jesus, why don't you do something about this? You know, I can't hear what you're saying. And finally, he got so perturbed about it that he told the demon, in the name of Jesus, get out of here. He said the thing just fell on the floor and trembled. And then Jesus and him were looking at each other, and he asked Jesus, why didn't you do something about that? And he said, Jesus said, I couldn't. Brother Hagin said, no, you mean you wouldn't. He said, no, I couldn't. I want you to get this. Because a lot of times we think God is supposed to be doing stuff, and God thinks you should be doing stuff. Amen. And he said, no, I've given you the authority over the demons on the earth. You have that authority. You need to exercise that authority. And then Jesus told him, he says, now listen to this. He said, nowhere in the New Testament does it tell the believer to pray to God to do something about the devil. Amen. But you and I are told several times that we're supposed to do something about the devil. Amen. And the problem is we are waiting for God. I've heard people for years say, well, if God wants me healed, he'll heal me. Well, as far as he's concerned, by Jesus' stripes on the cross, you were healed. If you don't know that and walk, believe it and walk in it, then you're going to miss the healing. And it's not because God hasn't done something. It's because you don't read the instruction manual and find out what belongs to you. Just like me, I didn't read the instruction manual to figure out how that thing worked. But when I read the instruction manual about by Jesus' stripes we're healed, and that Satan can't have my health anymore, and that I have authority over him, my wife and I, we've been at this ministry thing since 1985, and we've never missed a church service. And we used to have 4, 5, 6 services a week. We've never missed a church service because of sickness in over 35 years. Y'all out there? And it's not because we're so blessed. It's because we learned what our rights and responsibilities and our authority was. Amen. And when you learn your rights and your authority, you won't go through that junk either. Amen. Amen. And that's what God wants. He wants you to find out what your rights and what your privileges are and act on them and do something with it. Amen. Amen. I said amen. Amen. And so the New Testament never tells us, you know, if the devil starts accosting you, you pray to Jesus and he'll take care of it. It says you do something about it. Amen. Turn over to Matthew chapter 28. Y'all good? Matthew 28, verse 18. And it says, and Jesus came and spoke to them. I mean, you know, that's got to be good. He says, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. And some people go, see, Jesus has all the authority. Well, turn over to Mark chapter 16. Because Jesus said, all authority has been given to me on heaven and earth. And then he immediately, turn over there in your Bible. You need to read it for yourself. Don't just listen to me. Pay attention to the Bible. But then he immediately conferred all that authority onto you and I. Amen. Mark chapter 16, verse 15. He says, and he said unto them, go into all the world and preach the gospel. Who's supposed to be preaching the gospel? You are. Amen. Everyone in here is supposed to be preaching the gospel if you're born again. Amen. Jesus ain't preaching the gospel anymore. He says, you go preach the gospel. Amen. Amen. To every creature. Verse 16, he says, now watch this. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. Amen. God's not condemning people. He says they're already condemned. It's not like, well, they didn't choose me, so they're going to hell. No, people that haven't chosen Jesus are going to hell. You and I are supposed to preach the gospel so that we can receive them into heaven instead of hell. Now look at verse 17. How many believers we got in here? Praise God. And these signs will follow those who believe. In other words, if you're a believer, this is how it's demonstrated. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. Shandai. Shuma, shuma. They will take up serpents. That doesn't mean you have to go out and pick up serpents, but if, like Paul on the island, when the serpent came out of the fire and bit him, he just shook it off and kept on going. Yeah. It says, we'll take up serpents, and if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. How many of you know most sicknesses are recovering, not instant? Yeah. Come on. Get with the program. A lot of people come up and they get prayed for and they receive some relief and they say, well, I didn't get it. Now you got it, just keep talking and working it. Don't quit. Amen. So he says, these signs will follow any believer. Not the pastor, not the evangelist, but a believer. If you're a believer, this stuff's supposed to be going on in your life. Amen. Y'all over here? If you're a believer, this stuff should be working in your life.
Amen.
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 Well, I thought that was the pastor's job. Well, you thought wrong. It's not the pastor's job. It's the believer's job. It says all, did you read that? It's in the Bible. It's in the Bible. This means that at the name of Jesus, when you use that name, demons will flee. You have authority over the devil. Y'all out there, you have authority over the devil. And I remember when we first got into this back in 1982 in Klamath Assembly in Klamath Falls, and we got a hold of this word from Brother Hagin, and we were in the Assembly of God Church, and all the older people in the church were going, shh, don't talk about the devil. Don't make him mad. They were like afraid. Don't get the devil started because he'll mess up a lot of stuff. And we're like, mess up a lot of stuff? We're going to mess up the devil. We have authority. But they didn't know that. They didn't believe that. And they're like, ah! That's not the way Christians are supposed to be. Y'all out there? They knew well enough what he was up to. They just didn't know they could do anything about it. You know what he's up to in your life. Stealing, killing, and destroying, causing havoc. Raising you know what? Amen. But you have authority over him in the name of Jesus. Colossians 1:13 says this. This is the RSV. It says, God has delivered us from the dominion of darkness. God has delivered us from the dominion of darkness. The devil has no dominion over you. You ever heard somebody say, well, I just can't help it. I always screw up. I always do this. Well, yeah, you can help it. I can't help it. I just have to have another drink. I have to have another cigarette. No, you can help it. But you have to take authority in Jesus' name over that stuff. I smoke 3 packs of cigarettes a day, drink at least a half a case of beer every day, and a bunch of wine, and cussed at everybody I could find. I used to teach the sailors how to cuss. Thank God the Word of God works in my life, delivered me from all that junk. Are you out there? So God has already delivered you from the authority of darkness. You can't say, well, I can't help myself. Yeah, you can. Well, I'm just angry. Well, stop it. But it's in our family. Well, get a new family. Get saved and get in Jesus' family because we don't have that problem. Are you out there? I'm not trying to be funny either. I'm saying that you have authority over the devil and you need to exercise that authority. You need to do something with it. Amen. The Bible says those that believe will cast devils. That's the first thing it says, cast demons out. That doesn't mean you're going to go down the street, though, and cast devils out of everybody you see. We had a 35 years ago, something like that. We had that, man, everybody's running around. There's a demon behind every tree, and they're trying to cast the devil. Listen to me. If you're trying to do something like that, lay hands on the people or cast devils out or something, and it's all about bringing attention to you, you're wrong. If it's about a big show, you're wrong. If somebody needs a demon cast out of them, you take them in a room by yourself and somebody else and tend to business. You don't need to do it in the street, not the mall, so everybody can see how you are. That's pride. That's of the devil. And you'll probably get the devil you're trying to cast out, which I think has happened to a few people. Amen. But, you have authority in your own life. You're talking? You have authority. You fathers, I tell you all this all the time. I'm serious about it. We used to do this whenever we'd go move into a new house or something. We'd go around and put oil crosses all around over the windows and make sure the devil knew that house was no longer welcome for him. And every dad in here, you need to go to your house, get your family in back of you, open the door, and tell the devil to get out of that place and stay out. Get your sickness off my kids, your stupidity off my kids, get everything off my kids and my wife. No, everything that you brought in here is trash. You're done. Amen. And you're not working in my house anymore. Amen. We don't give place to you anymore. You're done. Right. Every dad. That's your responsibility. If you're a single mom, that's your responsibility. Let the devil know he's not welcome in your house anymore. You have that authority. Well, our kids get sick every year. Well, kick the devil out, they won't. I mean, we've got 35. How many years is that? It's a bunch. You know, the devil, he tried to come and put something on our kids. We just kick him out. Yeah, putting that on our kids. Get out of here. Y'all out there? James chapter 4, verse 7. Watch this. You know, one thing I found out is you can't cast the devil out of everybody. Some of them like him. I'm serious. Some people, they like the devil they got. They don't want to get rid of him. But James chapter 4, verse 7, watch this. Therefore, submit to God. What comes first? Submit to God. And what's the rest of it? Resist the devil, and he will flee from Jesus. Resist the devil, and he will flee from the Holy Ghost. What's it say? Resist the devil, and he will flee from who?
You.
Are y'all out there?
Yeah.
The Bible says that the devil will flee from you if you resist him. If you quit giving in to him, he'll have to go. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. He doesn't say he'll flee from Jesus. As far as he's concerned, you're just as big a problem as Jesus was. If you know who you are and what the Bible says about you. If you don't, then you're like the seven sons of Sceva who tried to cast out the demon, and the demon just looked at him and says, now, Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who in the world are you jokers? And then he scared all them because they didn't know who they were. They were just trying to use a name. Amen. Hallelujah. So 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. I want you to understand that in the Bible, you and I have been given authority, and we've been told to do something about the devil. We're just told to resist him. Amen. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 says this. It says, stay alert, watch out for your great enemy. How many of you know you got a great enemy? Amen. The Young's translation says you have an appointment or an opponent. You might have an appointment with the appointed. Well, an opponent, the devil. Amen. You have an enemy. If you don't know that, then he's just going to do all his stuff and you're just going to think, well, it's just God. No, there's a devil. You don't have to put up with all the junk that goes on in your life. Amen. I don't think they're getting it. Look at verse 9, 1 Peter 5, 9. Because he says, this is where, some people say, well, yeah, the devil, he's out there. I have an opponent. Ah! But look at verse 9. It says, you, doesn't say you, but it says you, stand firm against him and be strong in your faith. Amen. What's the Bible says? It doesn't say, now, Jesus will stand strong against the devil. It says, you stand strong against the devil. You stand against him, and you be strong in your faith. Don't let the devil just walk all over you and destroy your stuff. Don't let him steal your money. Don't let him steal your kids. Don't let him steal your joy. Don't let him steal your peace. Do something about it. Find out what the Bible says, and you do something about it. Amen? You're supposed to resist him. You're supposed to stand up to him. You're supposed to know you have authority. Devil, you can't just steal my stuff. You can't have my kids. You can't have my job, my money, nothing. Get out. Amen. Amen. You can't have my marriage. My wife started praying for us. That was a scary thing. But she did in Klamath Falls. She got a hold of that Holy Ghost thing and the Word and started praying for me. And God intervened because somebody found out their place in the Word of God. She found out she had authority over the devil in my house that was running me. Y'all out there? She told him he was done. Someday my husband's going to be an usher, you stupid devil. That was the best she could think of. But thank God she found out about it. I wonder what's going on in your house. That if you found out you had authority over it, you could stop it. I wonder what's going on in your life that the devil's just having fun beating you up with. If you found out you had authority over it, you could stop it. I said, devil, you're just such a liar. That is not who I am. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. Greater is he who's in me than he who's in the world. And devil, you're in the world. And you're going down. Amen?
Amen.
I want you to get this. You don't have to be beat up by the devil. You don't have to. You know, Jesus didn't come back to increase the shopping malls. He came back to get you and I back. The little manger thing, that wasn't so that Walmart and everybody could sell stuff. The manger thing was to get you back to Jesus. Get you back to the Father. So you could walk in the victory and the authority that God put us here for in the first place. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, I hope you got something today. What I want you to do again before we leave this morning is I want you to get in groups of three or four, and I want you to talk about one thing that you got this morning. Just get with some people right near you and talk about one thing you got this morning. And I'm doing this because a lot of times people go home and they can't remember what the sermon was. But if you vocalize it, you'll remember it. Amen.